vested in me, I hereby constitute this gathering a gathering of Cornerstone Institute for the purposes of the awarding of degrees and diplomas and certificates. You may be seated.
Good morning. The Bible reading for this morning is taken from Luke chapter 10, verse 25 and following. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever you have spent.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robber?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Let us pray. Our gracious and loving Father, in solidarity you are with us in the loss of life across our country, with us in the brokenness of our society, with us in the turbulence and distress of a world so deeply fractured, with us in the trenches. We ask that you inspire, mobilize, and energize us to serve selflessly, to love generously, to learn broadly, to shed tears with the widows, aliens, and orphans, with the dispossessed, the disenchanted, and the godforsaken, to celebrate joyfully, to suffer graciously. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of second chances and new beginnings, God who makes the impossible possible, God of compassion, love, and superabundant grace, we give you thanks for stepping into our world, for the homecoming you initiate, for your faithfulness to the end. You have carried us, you have carried our students, and we are grateful. We are overwhelmed, and we are ready. Ready to go into the world, ready to read our world, ready to respond to our world, ready to embrace our neighbors. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Noel Daniels, and I'm the CEO of Cornerstone Institute. This is my 101st day at Cornerstone, and it's a deep honor for me, and I'm very humbled by the opportunity to be able to address such an esteemed group of people who've gathered here today to celebrate. This is a celebration. My script for my welcome is on the first page of the program, as you have, each one of you should have received. But I'm not going to read it. I'm just going to highlight one or two things. What has really impressed me was that the Cornerstone faculty and staff and the board members of Cornerstone all converged onto a single definition that kind of framed what we all thought the university should be. And it's very interesting that that definition was tabled back in 1852 already by John Henry Newman, who many of you sitting in the audience will know, you'll know his work. He ended the definition by saying that the university is a place where inquiry is pushed forward, discovery is verified and perfected, and errors exposed by collision of mind with mind and knowledge with knowledge. Now, we would like to believe that all our graduating students have in fact experienced that at Cornerstone. They come here today as proud diplomats, proud billboards, having made the sacrifices that were required in order for them to reach the status of having either a certificate, a diploma, or a degree, including an honors degree. We have a number of honors degree candidates conferred on them today. So we know that it takes sacrifice to do this. It doesn't come easy. But we also know that you can't do it on your own. So we are very grateful to you. We are very grateful to you, the parents, the family, the friends, who are called the cheerleaders of our mainly young graduates. Of course, we have an inclusive policy, and we'd like to see both fresh from school candidates at our university, as well as mature students. So the programs that we offer include everybody. We move within the framework of the Constitution of the Republic of South Africa, which is an inclusive constitution and considered to be one of the best, if not the best, in the world. And at Cornerstone, we live that. We live that inclusivity. Everybody's welcome to come and study at Cornerstone and experience what it is that we have to offer. We do have to meet a criteria to get in, so we will apply it. We are very concerned with providing a quality education, and we've always been, and we will continue to do that. So people, I don't want to take over what the keynote speaker today will be addressing, but I do want to say to you that we are here to say well done to the graduates, and we know that on your own you can go far, but with others you can go further. And I think today, in welcoming you, I'm wanting to say that Cornerstone is that kind of place. That kind of place that takes you further. Because at Cornerstone, we indeed want you to learn to change the world for the better. In terms of, if you will allow me just to demonstrate the welcoming and invitational approach that we have at Cornerstone. We're continuing the celebrations with a lunch after this, and then this evening we have a gala event. There will be a dinner, and there will be live music from 7 to 10 o'clock at Cornerstone. I want to invite you, because I have some sponsored complimentary tickets. I would like to be able to prioritize the graduates and their families, if they're free this evening, to come to Cornerstone, and myself and our faculty officer, Marcel. Marcel, where are you? Marcel's at the back there. We'll be standing at a table outside, taking down your detail. It's the first come, first serve, because there are limited spaces. And those of you who come and speak to Marcel and or I, we will take your name and include you at our gala event tonight. We have been selling tickets for 350 rand a ticket, but we've had quite a few sponsors saying, please invite the graduates and their families to come and join us at the gala. I know you may have made plans already and it's very late notice, but you are welcome. And tomorrow evening, we're all going to end off our festival of learning that we've been having at Cornerstone recently with a celebration at the Artscape. We've been invited as the guest of Artscape Theatre to attend a theatrical event there. And again, we have complimentary, And again, myself and or I will be waiting for you at the table outside. If any of you are around tomorrow evening, it's a show that starts at 6 o'clock, and you're invited to come and join us. People, that's just very symbolically saying to you that at Cornerstone, we want you to cast the net wide. We want you to say, come and join us. Cornerstone is a great place to be. And that's the message of welcome to you today. But I'm not going to hold it up any further because I know you're all waiting for the main part of today, besides, of course, the capping itself. And that is to listen to some pearls of wisdom from a very inspirational person that we have in our midst. In fact, if it wasn't for this person, I'm prepared to stand here today and say that Cornerstone would not exist. And that person, people, is the president of our institution, Dr. John Barming. I quickly want to honor him with an introduction that does justice to what this man has achieved. I get very emotional when I talk about him, because I know him from a young age. When I wanted to go and study overseas, I got a scholarship to study at Berkeley. It was John who mentored me, who advised me on what I needed to do. And, sorry, I must obey my composure. And now, much later in my life, I get to sit at his feet. And I'm very, very honored by that. You know that John's been involved in education all his life. He's committed his life to education. He was born and raised in Cape Town, South Africa, so he's a homeboy. He started his academic career at the University of the Western Cape, and he completed a PhD in mathematics education at Cornell University in the United States of America back in 1988. He started his career as a high school teacher, and he became the head of mathematics at the then Peninsula Technicon, which is now known as CPUT, Cape Peninsula University of Technology. He held various teaching positions at other institutions, including the University of the Western Cape, the University of Cape Town, and Cornell University, from which he did alma mater. After 25 years in the state, he grew tired of North America and decided Africa was where he wanted to be. So he came home and joined the University of Botswana in Gaborone, and he returned to South Africa in 1991. He immediately got involved in development initiatives, including being the director of the Center for the Advancement of Science and Mathematics Education, which was based in Durban. John later served as campus vice principal at the then University of Natal, and thereafter became the Pro Vice Chancellor of Partnership at the University until 2004. During his time at the University of KwaZulu-Natal, he was responsible for partnership programs with business, government, and the community, and he served as the Executive Director of the Development Foundation of the University. I'm highlighting that because John is driven by partnership. He really believes sincerely and honestly, as part of his very being, that we need to work together, that we should work in unison and find the means to combine our energies and our resources so that we can indeed go further. And he has lived that. John is centrally involved in curriculum reform in South Africa, specifically in post-apartheid South Africa, and he worked with all four ministries of education. The ministers of education, as personally all four our ministers, including Blaine Zamande, has called on him to say, come and help. And he always stepped up to the plate. Recently, he'd been appointed as CEO of the National Education Evaluation and Development Unit, which is NEDU. But more importantly, he served as chairperson of the Umalusi Council, who's responsible for administering and monitoring and evaluating and running the matric exams nationally. And he's the boss. He's the man on top. And he did it for 4 years. It's a very very hard job, can one imagine? And Lady of the Mind, they called on him again. Why? Because he did such an excellent job the first time around. And currently, he again serves. So this current Matric examination, he is the head of Umarusi, he's responsible for the quality of our Matric examination. John, of course, you know, he's always up to a challenge, although we all kind of feel that, you know, rather him than us, because the job is so daunting. Currently, he's not only dealing with a number of examination leaks that has happened, fortunately not in our province, but in other provinces, but nationally it impacts on us. And more sadly, he's having to deal with a number of irregularities with regard to the appointment of people in the education system, where posts have actually been sold. And John needs all the resources that he had to manage the situation so that it doesn't turn into a crisis and bring our entire education system down. We may not realize how important it is to deal with our human resource management matters in a very proper way. In our country, we've got the legislation to ensure equity, to ensure fairness of employment. And if those regulations and those laws are skirted, we are digging holes for ourselves. So for John to take on this kind of work at this time, when most of us are thinking about our holidays and the Christmas season and the new year and taking a break, John is busy dealing with the tick examination, making sure that the integrity of it is not compromised in any way. So then, John, we salute you from Cornerstone side. We are proud that you are our president. He served on the Cornerstone board, but he's a sucker for punishment. So he serves on a number of other boards as well. Works in the non-governmental development organizations across education, health, and community upliftment. He's involved in leadership development programs for members of parliament, and he holds the position of extraordinary professor at Northwest University at the Mafeking campus. John is a homeboy in all sense of the words. He still lives in Athlone. He's not moved to the leafy suburbs. He's made it his business to make sure that Athlone is transformed into a place that's safe and comfortable and a joyous experience in terms of wanting to create a home for him and his family. His family of 10 children. 10 children. People don't put too much into this because 5 of them are adopted. The other 5 are his own. So John and his wife, Ingela, who was also a teacher, worked together in voluntary community projects. They work in Athlone, they work with young people, and he knows how challenging it is to bring up a child. And he knows that when your child graduates, as a parent, this is one of the happiest moments in your life. And I'm sure for you graduates, this must be one of your happiest moments in your life. Congratulations for what's about to come, and I'd like to hand you over to John, and can I ask you to give him a round of applause.
Thank you so much, Noel, for that very kind introduction. Distinguished guests, graduates, ladies and gentlemen, it's a profound honor for me to be here today to participate in this very significant event at an institution that I deeply respect and value. And the reason why we gathered here today is to celebrate achievement. And achievement on the part of people who are on my right, who have given of their best both in time and in commitment. You know, it's the time of the year, and I'm also one of those. It's December. There are only 26 days or 25 days left in the year. And it's a time of the year when you ask yourself, what have I actually achieved this year? And many of us, myself included, would feel somewhat disappointed that we didn't own the resolutions that we made. Remember the last hour of 2014 and the first hour when we all had new visions of what we're going to be this year. And now we're sitting here a year later and we haven't moved one inch. And today we can take inspiration from a group of wonderful people, mostly young, I believe, who were willing to do whatever was necessary. During the past year, and sometimes 2 years, some have been here for 4 years, in order to reach heights that they never thought possible. To honor the commitments, it's always very important, to own your commitments and to honor them that they've made to God and to themselves and to their loved ones. That's a source of inspiration for you. So you're graduating here today, it's an inspiration, and it helps me rediscover my own courage to think bigger than. So maybe I'll go become a first-year student. Today I want to say to you that you not only graduate and walk away with a qualification, that you become members of the alumni of a very unique higher education institution. You may ask, what makes Cornerstone unique? And I want to just spend some time just to explain why Cornerstone is unique. I have been privileged to have worked in several universities in different parts of the world and studied there. But universities, or as we call it, higher education institutions, are known in the first place as what I call a knowledge organization, which means that universities would like in the first place everyone to know. And when you know, and you can demonstrate that you know, then you are awarded with a degree or another qualification. But you must know. There's nothing wrong with that. I must say, I see one of my colleagues that shared a room with me when I first went to Ithaca, New York, Professor Jan Pessens, who was, he's a really good mathematician, unlike me. So he's a professor of mathematics at the University of Western Cape. And he and I shared a room at the beginning. It was lonely days, Jan. But I can remember those days when I asked myself, you know, it's fine to know things, but how much learning actually takes place? It's different. And Cornerstone would like to believe that it's not just a knowing organization, but a learning organization. And when we say learn, there is a UNESCO publication that's very interesting, and I always like to take my bearings from there. When you say, what do you come to learn? When you say learn, you come to learn four things. You learn to know. And when you say that, that's the first one. It's not about pursuing knowledge for the sake of knowledge. Although we at Cornerstone recognize that there's great value in a broad body of knowledge, but it's also about knowing God in Christ, and through that knowledge get to know ourselves and get to know our world in a deeper way. Then there's secondly learning to do, not only learning to know, learning to do. And again, for us at Cornerstone, this means more than acquiring an occupational skill, but indeed to acquire the competence to deal with the many complex situations in the real world. I have to deal with it all the time. And I'm sure you also. We're a community of practice that learns through doing. You know, when going back to the Bible, when God spoke to Moses and gave him a task, God didn't say to Moses, "What is in your head?" He says, "What is in your hand?" And Moses had to learn to do. And then thirdly, learning to live with others. So learning to know, learning to do, learning to live with others. Cornerstone is a community where we celebrate diversity, as Noel has said. And in South Africa, we have been brought up believing that the differences between us, based on race, based on ethnicity, and class, is more real and more enduring than our common humanity. And at Cornerstone, we are learning to live together in a way that expresses our common unity in Christ, but as well as our common humanity with others. So we shall respect each other here at Cornerstone. We shall affirm each other and support each other in a way that shows that we have learned to live together in a vibrant and in a loving community. And then fourthly, learning to be. You know, Jonathan Jansen, who grew up in the same church as I did, and he often says, you know, in South Africa, we're doing a reasonable job learning to know, and we're sort of getting to know what it means to learning to do. And we kind of, despite all the problems, learning to live together. But we haven't got the foggiest idea what it means to learn to be. Each one of us must learn to be everything that we could possibly be and that God wants us to be. We should learn, therefore, to resist any attempts by anyone to make us less than what God intended for our lives, whether they're Christians or not. I mean, I've been held back more by Christians than by non-Christians. More discouragement from Christians than I got from non-Christians. So part of the vision of Cornerstone is to keep that focus. Be what God wants you to be. But over and above those four commonly held ways of learning, Cornerstone has, if you see the strap line of Cornerstone, you will see that it has introduced a fifth reason for learning. And it's on the materials that you will see, and that is learning to change the world. We are all aware that we live in a troubled world. I was shocked when I heard that in America, in the 300 days that have gone so far, you had 300 shootings in America. There are mass shootings almost every day. I'm sometimes too scared to turn on CNN, let alone ENCA. There's police violence, there's domestic violence, there's sexual violence, and several other forms of expressions of inhumanity. I always say, you know, if you have love in your heart, you never do things like that. We know also that we live in a troubled country, not just in a troubled world. This is a troubled country, where people in general, and young people in particular, no longer believe in institutional change. The ruling party and leadership in general in this country have lost its political and moral authority. And so we see all kinds of arbitrary and violent attempts to bring about change and alterations of policy through mass mobilization. And this year, we saw ample manifestations of this at public universities all over the world. And I'm on the council of three universities in this country. And the damage is done at these universities is unspeakable. Now, I would agree that it is true that judgments about policy cannot be viewed as a fixed privilege of any particular group. elites or non-elites. But what we need at this time in this country is to restore the institutionalization of reasoned procedures and informed debates and consent around critical issues instead of wanton violence. And in the light of these challenges, we could ask the question, what kind of people do we want to see coming out of our education system and institutions? As part of a transformed and an admirable society. So when I want to see who comes out of our schools and comes out of our universities, I'm not only looking for people who are multi-skilled, who are literate and numerate. That doesn't really impress me. It's nice to have those. But in addition, I would like to see people who are confident and independent and compassionate and environmentally respectful and able to participate in society as critical and active citizens. So we have to ask the obvious follow-up question, what kind of institution, instructors, curriculum and educational ethos will be needed in order to produce such people? And that, in short, is what Cornerstone aspires to be. You know, I've been part of Cornerstone as a principal here for 5 years, when I left the University of Natal. And I remember then, as it is now, that Cornerstone has always brought about new ways of considering what counts as knowledge. And also it creates opportunities for students to question and to inquire and to doubt and to create and construct new perspectives about themselves and society. So Cornerstone has always challenged the pedagogy of preservation that simply promotes an uncritical allegiance to existing power relations. The mistake that many institutions of higher learning all over the world make is that they draw an impenetrable boundary. You think about a circle, if they draw a circle, everything inside is a university, everything outside is not. And it is my view that you can never define excellence within such a truncated reality. It has to be the case that if you define excellence in Africa and excellence in South Africa, you have to go beyond those boundaries. And if you must involve a university, must involve embracing it, the community around it. And to reach a university that is dynamically engaged with its community. So we need a new country. We need a new moral system. We need a new world. And you can't capture that with technical planning. It's got to do with values. Cornerstone strives to be a university that is engaged with its community. We need to understand that when somebody graduates from Cornerstone, we expect those graduates to live out this mission in the world. But of course, I always say that's a matter of choice. You know, there's a very nice author, Michael Josephson, he says, living a life that matters doesn't happen by accident. It's not a matter of circumstance, but of choice. So you choose. You don't have to live a life that matters. You can just exist. But living a life of that matters is a choice. And so he says, choose a life, to live a life that matters. As a Christian, now I speak as a Christian. The choice I made as a young person is to be present with Christ in the world. And for me, being a Christian is standing with Christ amidst both the confusion and the order alike. It is standing in that place in the world where Christ has chosen to be. that you're standing with him in the midst of brokenness and the hatred of the world. You stand there in his name and in his presence. And that's not necessarily a place of power, or a place of glamour, a place of comfort or prestige. But standing with Christ is always a place of significance. And it does not bring about change by force, but by compassion, and by making way for God's truth in Christ. So I close, and I want to close with a few remarks about why this year, 2015, will go down as one of the most significant years of Cornerstone. You know, any institution has a beginning, an ancestry. It has a genealogy, it has a biography. And in October this year, we pay tribute to the founder of Cornerstone, Dr. Don Ashen, who almost 50 years ago established with his wife Eva the Cape Evangelical Bible Institute on the Cape Flats. He passed away in October in his hometown in the United States. And we will always remain indebted to him for his sacrificial and servant leadership. And then the next one of the leaders was Dr. Alan Jansen, with whom I meet regularly. He and I, every few weeks, we have coffee together. And I want to say I have great respect for Alan. And he took CEBI, Cape Evangelical Bible Institute, and he changed it to be known as Cornerstone Christian College. And Cornerstone Christian College, for the first time, awarded degrees. And those degrees were awarded through Stellenbosch University. And later on, Cornerstone gave its own degrees, with full accreditation from the Council on Higher Education. Today, Cornerstone is an institution of about 400 students. And it offers a variety of degrees and diplomas and certificates, some of those you will see here today. But I want to say this, 2015 was in many ways a watershed year for Cornerstone. One of the most challenging years because it faced imminent closure. And for a number of reasons, most significantly financial reasons. And had it not been for the intervention and generosity of my friend and well-known philanthropist Marcel Golding, Cornerstone would not have survived this year. I know he does not want me to say this, but Marcel has poured in several millions of rands. All I can say is more than 10 million since August out of his pocket in order to salvage the things that remain. I won't go into the reasons for that, but Marcel Golding stood in the breach when there was no one else to serve as a benefactor. Now, when I sleep at night, I sleep comfortably, because I know the Cornerstone is in good hands. Marcel, I want to say to you, history will judge you kindly. And I also want to say, you know, we serve a God that has a habit of taking notes. God always takes notes. So thank you, Marcel. Marcel has brought with him a new team. And he's the chairman of the board. And this new team operates under Noel Daniels. And every time I hear Noel speak, I'm more and more surprised. I forgot, Noel, that I was the one involved in your bursary to America. But I also am very much impressed about Noel's organizing ability and his professionalism. I work with a lot of people, but I yet have to see somebody so committed to a task. So what an excellent job they've done so far. Thank you. I Let's not forget those who have continued to serve Cornerstone over the years. People like Caroline DeWitt and Margie Gustafson and Rob Stegman here on the stage. Caroline, stay on the stage. Geraldine Franciscus on the stage. These are people that, despite the many difficulties, see difficulty in his face and says that he will continue, and lots of these other people are. There's just too many to mention him by name. But I want you to know that we deeply appreciate that and value that. You didn't run to the hills. So Cornerstone is still on a journey. It has a career. It doesn't only have a genealogy, it has a career. And we must allow it to grow into that career. We shouldn't pretend we can capture it and freeze it. But we should do so, when we allow it to grow, we should do so with due respect and recognition of its heritage and its underlying ethical, social, philosophical, and faith foundations. Rob Stegman, who's the dean, gave me a nice analogy yesterday when I spoke to him at the board meeting. But he says the way you should see Cornerstone is that it's like a tree that's growing. And when a tree grows, every year it gets a new annual ring. It does not mean that the other rings disappear. In fact, it can't. So as Cornerstone develops its career, it will add other rings. But those initial rings that was laid by Dr. Asherman and others will always remain. So, I'm going to sit down, but graduates, this is your moment. And you know, I often am at the airport, and I hate airports. I hate airports, so I go there at the last minute, so that I don't have to wait. But there are lounges at the airports, and there's a South African airline lounge, and I don't, anyway, let me not say anything about South African airline. So I often go to the British Airways Lounge. So, and the British Airways Lounge, as many of you would know, is called the Snow Lounge. And so when I asked him, but why is this thing called the Snow Lounge? And they tell me that it's because time is not measured by years or months or days, but by moments. So as I think over my life, I cannot remember every day. I cannot even remember every year, but I can remember those special moments. And this is your moment. So enjoy it. Take your time. That's why it's called the slow lunch. Today you are on the slow lunch. Take it all in and enjoy it. God bless you. Thank you.
Firstly, allow me to say congratulations on this momentous occasion, your graduation, and to say how incredibly proud we are of you as an institution. For many of you, this has been both a challenging but yet exciting journey. Some of you have faced many obstacles. Your family has had to make personal sacrifices for you to be here today. But challenges is what makes your life interesting, and overcoming these obstacles is what actually makes your life meaningful. But the day has arrived, and we are here to celebrate your achievement. May this be a time for looking back on lessons learned both inside the class and outside of the class, to reflect on those bright moments that was filled with special meanings and memories and all the friendships you've made. It's a time to say farewell, but it's also a time for new beginnings. It's a time to look forward, a time to actually just reflect on your experience, to start setting new goals for yourself, to dream new dreams, and to actually spread your wings out even further. In the words of Emerson, what lies behind you and what lies before you are small matters in comparison with what lies within you. So our wish for you is that you would be lifelong learners going out to make a difference and change the world, to give of what's been given to you. As education, the great aim of education is not just knowledge, it's action as well. So may your futures be bright as you live fully engaged in the world with others, experiencing meaning and finding purpose. And may you be more than just significant, may you be more than just successful, may you be significant and impactful, sharing the gift of education with others as well. And wherever you go with all your heart, may you live fully, and may God's blessings rest on you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let me just start with some water first. It's good to be here. Again, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. 2015 has been arguably one of the most challenging years in the history of Cornerstone. Now, it is no surprise, it is no secret, for the most part of the year, Cornerstone has been in a terrible financial state. The situation was so dire that some staff members were not receiving their full salaries in consecutive months, and the problems further escalated to the point where students in arrears were asked to leave the institution. They were expelled from the institution. Now, crisis situations have the ability to expose the fundamental nature and core beliefs of an organization. This crisis in Cornerstone has brought to the surface some different conflicts of ideas and has exposed contradictions inherent in the institution. The conflicts were primarily those between capital and labor, where we saw staff being retrenched, and the main contradiction was the commoditization of a basic human need, The conflict of interest. The main contradiction was the commoditization of basic human needs, just opposed to the fundamental freedom to have one's needs satisfied. So although we have an access to quality tertiary education, the majority of the population remains excluded from that education because it has a price tag on it. Now, we know that this challenge is not peculiar to Cornerstone as an institution. We've seen this in the Fees Must Fall movements and the end of outsourcing that have been nationwide. Ladies and gentlemen, these challenges are characteristic of an oppressive, market-driven capitalist economy. An economic system that alienates people from basic necessities and benefits a minority at the expense of a majority. It is an economy that was constituted in extreme violence through colonial conquest, dispossession, genocide, and the exploitation of human labor. The economy that instituted white supremacy and remains hell-bent on preserving white privilege. This we know, we have come to the realization that Cornerstone community, with its Christ-centered and biblically shaped worldview, is not immune from the forces of this capitalist economy. We have seen this in the retrenchments of staff, the exclusion of students, and the exponential increases in tuitions. The registration fee for next year is 10,500 Rand. And in the midst of all of this, there was not a single dissenting voice from the academics, the theologians, the ethicists. There was no talk about the kingdom of God, or the common good, jubilee, or shalom, all concepts that we're used to in a Christian environment. And all these have been rendered to empty words, words without praxis. The status quo persists, and there remains no good news for the poor. In his book titled The Treason of Intellectuals, Julian Bender writes that intellectuals have two choices. They can serve privilege and power, or they can serve truth and justice. The more concessions intellectuals make to privilege and power, those who build careers, little monuments to themselves, or seek to claw upwards within institutions, or want to make money, they must always make these concessions. And the more they make these concessions, they diminish their capacity for truth and justice. Finally, to my fellow graduates, in the words of Fanon, out of relative obscurity, each generation must discover its mission, fulfill it, or portray it. The South African class of 2015 has discovered its mission, to decolonize Africa, to outroot white supremacy and the preservation of white privilege in all its manifestations, to realize the total liberation of humanity, which will be achieved through the total emancipation of Africa. My fellow compatriots, I implore you to be lovers of Africa and all the children, because only actions informed by love can undo centuries of hatred and violence that have been inflicted on Africa, the cradle of humanity. Izwele to my Africa. Thank you very much.
Afternoon, it's not yet 12, I look at the clock at the back, and it's I think 1 minute or 2 minutes to 12. So I want to say good afternoon, but I feel like it's good evening because the day has been so long for us. I think my fellow graduates can feel the same way. But good morning, ladies and gentlemen, staff and faculty of Cornerstone, members of the board, and especially to the graduating class of 2015. I would like to start off with Isaiah 25 verse 1, which reads, I will exalt you and praise your name. Sorry, I'm a bit nervous. Let me just collect myself a bit. I will exalt you and praise your name. For in perfect faithfulness, you have done marvelous things, things planned long ago. I believe we are each sitting here today as recipients of God's perfect faithfulness. It's gonna make my hand shake.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. I believe that we are each sitting here today as recipients of God's perfect faithfulness, that today is a result of things planned long ago by our Father. As I reflected on how to best represent the student journey, all of which I'm sure looks very differently to each of us, I found that every road led to three crucial places. Please follow me. The first of these is character. Cornerstone has not only been a place of learning, and this journey has not only been an academic one. Along the way, there have certainly been challenges, more like opportunities that required more than what we sometimes thought we possessed. These were opportunities that allowed us to see our lack, to discover our abilities, and to grow in our character. Maybe it was the annoying photocopy machine in the library, or the funda hang-ups, or perhaps those midnights of painful referencing, as my fellow graduates will know. But it was those sometimes treacherous moments that caused us to grow in discipline, patience, perseverance, faith, and so much more. This journey has been nothing short of a transformation of our character. I do not think any of my fellow graduates are leaving here today the same people that they were when they first started on this road. Perhaps that is because sometimes the road we are walking is just as significant as the destination we are heading to. And the road at Cornerstone has certainly been significant. The second place this journey has led us to is purpose. I think this is the one that we each started our journey at Cornerstone with. Some of us came to discover our purpose, some to pursue it, and others to start living it. In one way or another, this journey started with our purpose in mind. And perhaps we are still unsure, or maybe more assured as we take the stage today. Either way, we will continue this journey in the same place we started it at. And that's an evaluation of our purpose. So to my fellow graduates, as we continue to discover, embrace, and walk in our purpose, I want to share the hope of 1 Corinthians 2 verse 9, that no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has conceived the things that God has prepared for those who love Him. This promise makes the journey so much more exciting. The third and final place I believe every road in this journey has led us to is relationships. I'm not speaking to an empty room here today. Instead, when I look around, I see acquaintances, I see friends, family, I see a community. That is because we could never have walked this road alone. Throughout this journey, I believe relationships are one of the more exciting places to be in, although I'm sure our family and friends are as relieved as we are that we have finally reached the end. It's been a long road. But we needed the laughs, the encouragement, the coffee dates, and sometimes the shoulder to cry on. Old relationships were strengthened, and new ones were developed. I don't think there is a single graduating student here today who is not grateful for what the journey at Cornerstone has done for the relationships of their lives. Many of us leave here with lifetime friends who were once strangers. So, I hope I'm speaking for every graduate here today, as some of them had some things to say to me earlier this morning. But I speak for every graduate here today when I say that without the staff and faculty of Cornerstone, without our friends and family, without each one of you in this room, and without each other, this journey would be neither possible nor worth it. So on that note, on behalf of the graduating class of 2015, I would like to give a heartfelt thanks to each and every one of you in this room. Thank you all so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, we come now to that moment in this celebration. We're going to get started with the awarding of the certificates and the degrees and diplomas. Mr. President, I present to you the following candidates who have successfully completed the program requirements and have fulfilled all the conditions as accepted by the Board of Directors, the Academic Office, our accrediting bodies, and the Senate, which now enables the candidates to be awarded the following certificates. Higher Certificate in Business Studies. In absentia, David Edwin Hall with distinction. In absentia, Elizabeth Lawrence. Debony Rachel Parsons. Higher Certificate in Community Counseling. In absentia, Anna Paula Leontina De Angelis. In absentia, Amanda Lee Hansen. Not in absentia, Kondwani Harawa. Sadia Hendricks. In absentia, Victoria Mercy Pillay. Grace Prince. Higher Certificate in Interior Design and Decoration. In absentia, Bertina Galacki. Mr. President, I present to you the following candidates who have successfully completed the program requirements and have fulfilled all of the conditions as accepted by the Board of Directors, the Academic Office, our accrediting bodies, and the Senate, which now enables the candidates to be awarded the Advanced Diploma in Intermediate Phase Teaching. In absentia, Leanne Kluter. In absentia, Petronella Erasmus. Janine Grobler. Renita Natasha Jaffa with distinction. Bernice Jason Meider. Shireen Orphan with distinction. In absentia, Bibi Ayeshe Patel. In absentia, Daniel Andrew Raven. In absentia, Liesl Jane Reynolds. In absentia, Shakara Rousseau. In absentia, Darren James Smith. Jacqueline van Heerden with distinction. Mr. President, I now present to you to confer the Bachelor of Arts degree upon the following candidates who have successfully completed the program requirements and have fulfilled all the conditions of this qualification. Bachelor of Arts, Glenda Serena Bites.
I confer upon you the degree Bachelor of Arts.
Sintandile Faku.
Bachelor of Arts.
Jay Lafleur. Sindiso Lobani.
Thank you, Lobani.
Janine Persons. Elvina Karumo.
Bachelor of Arts.
Vanel Margareta Schulze.
Bachelor of Arts.
Eden Emily Thackeray with distinction. Thank you very much. Lorna van der Soe with distinction. Thank you very much. Amy van Geer.
Thank you very much.
Taryn Williams.
Thank you, God.
Mr. President, I now request you to confer the Bachelor of Theology and Community Leadership degree upon the following candidates who have successfully completed the program requirements and have fulfilled all the conditions of this qualification. Bachelor of Theology and Community Leadership, Stephanie Kim Bam.
I confer upon you the degree Bachelor of Theology in Community Leadership.
Ashley Dooman. Manifume Gonteka. In absentia, Martins Usman Martin Ibi. Busisiwe Nelbani. Elvi Murray with distinction. Philip Ragette.
Bachelor of Theology.
In absentia, Nkaniso Cyril Shange. Candice Wilson with distinction. Mr. President, I now request you to confer the Bachelor of Arts Honours degree upon the following candidates who have successfully completed the program requirements and have fulfilled all the conditions of this qualification. Bachelor of Arts Honours. In absentia, Malebojo Abesai. Haley Andrea Abrahams.
I'm still coming with a degree Bachelor of Arts Honours in Psychology.
Liesl Armour with distinction.
Bachelor of Arts honor.
Robin Armstrong.
Bachelor of Arts honor.
In absentia, John David Day with distinction. Dominique Ann Cochran.
Bachelor of Arts honor.
Robin Rochelle Davids.
Bachelor of Arts honor.
Cordelia Faleni.
Bachelor of Arts honor.
Johannes Pietrus Pierce.
Bachelor of Arts honors.
In absentia, Deborah Pearl Julies. Christian Carlin.
Bachelor of Arts honors.
Bryony Gwyneth Kramer with distinction.
Bachelor of Arts honors.
Henry John Kruth with distinction. Taryn Little. Katsefo Dudu Etsang Mato Ote. In absentia, Wachepo Ko Moje. Rosemary Caroline Ayago Awaga. Paul Edward Rue.
Bachelor of Arts honors.
Alexis Joanne Salis.
talking about honor.
Soraya Sussman.
Talking about honor.
Kirsten Lynn Schlesinger with distinction. Janelle Kelly Thompson. In absentia, Helena Trudeau. Abongile Zibikili Tswane.
Thank you very much. Come on.
Right, we come now to the awarding of our academic awards. Mr. President and Chairperson of the Board, esteemed colleagues, graduates, and invited guests, it is my privilege to present the Academic Merits Award for 2015. As indicated on the last page of the program, the academic award is presented to the graduate who has achieved the highest academic standard during the course of his or her studies at Cornerstone Institute. In order to be eligible for this award, a student must have completed the qualification in a maximum of 1 year more than the minimum amount of the time required for the program. An award is presented for each of the following categories in the higher certificate, bachelor program, and postgraduate programs. Our winner for the higher certificate this year, unfortunately in absentia, is David Hall. The award for the bachelor degree for 2015 goes to Eden Emily Thackeray. Postgraduate program award for this year goes to Renita Natasha Jaffa.
I have the distinct honor and privilege of handing out the Against All Odds Award. But before I read the citation, I just maybe want to make a few comments. Today is obviously a very auspicious occasion for all the graduates. And for me, it's particularly delightful because having graduated twice at the University of Cape Town some 35 years ago, I never ever attended a graduation. So for the first time, I've
I've been able to experience what a graduation is, put on a gown that I've never put on before. So it's for me quite an awesome experience to see young people start on a long journey of a purposeful life. So I hope that the journey you have over the next few decades will be exciting and interesting, and that you'd contribute and make South Africa a better place, that we contribute to our country and make the studies that you had really meaningful. So the citation for the Against All Odds is the following. The purpose of the All Odds Award is to recognize the graduating student who has overcome unusual and extenuating circumstances. Against all odds, the student has determined to reach his or her goals in spite of those obstacles and has remained at Cornerstone, maintaining past grades and successfully completing the requirements of their program of study. The criteria for this award are courage and determination, integrity, and good standing in the Cornerstone community. That Against All Odds Award for 2015 is awarded to Shireen Orphan.
Finally, a candidate for the President's Award was judged by the faculty, staff, and students as the student that best represents the core values of Cornerstone. While it is recognized that this candidate may not be the student with the highest academic standing, it must nevertheless be the case that he or she possesses all the qualities that we celebrate as an institute. And to this end, the President's Award will be given to a final year student who has shown consistency of Christian character, is actively involved in the church as well as adjunctive ministries, outreach work, community projects, and is supportive of fellow students, has demonstrated academic excellence, and is well balanced spiritually, socially, and academically. This year's candidate for the President's Award, unfortunately, did not make it here today. And his reward will be received in absentia by the Student Services, Dr. Sarani Symington. Now, great pleasure in announcing that this year's President's Award goes to Nkanyiso Chang.
So, Dr. Symington will just keep the award there. Thank you.